One apology from Phil Davis, go ahead.
Okay, okay.
We've got Chris Meaton, who's very kindly agreed to.
Four.
Anthony?
Four.
Four, super subs.
Super subs, four, Peter.
Chair, my apologies for answering one of these.
Oh, right, okay, thank you very much. Declaration of interest, and then we've got your declaration of interest. Can I ask you to look at the minutes of the meeting of 20th of November, pages 1 to 8, and those who are here, can you ask if I can read them accurately on board? Good, thank you. And the minutes of the Standard Constitutional Oversight and Working Group, and I believe there's a change to the date of a meeting on this one, whereby it's got the 14th of March, and with the change of date, the next meeting is the 23rd. And we'll note that, thank you very much. And the next item on the agenda is item 5. And Phil, do you want to talk through this? It's building the public meetings and plans to introduce this at the next annual council, and it's something we discussed at the working group the other week. Phil, do you want to talk through
this? Chair, you have before you asked me if you prepared, who you thought it? So the council is proposing to move to webcasting. The date for going live should be, I say should. I almost said would there, but then stopped saying that. Should be with the NMA. So backed up in all of that actually is a policy that the council should hopefully have in terms of recording of meetings. Up to date, the council has relied on the quite short guidance from DCLG. That's expanded and gone into some further detail in the paper that's before you for adoption. So, if you have any questions, to Patrick or I on the details.
I think we have looked at this at the working group, and we're happy with the protocols that is here.
Yeah.
I have had a request from Mr. Brace. I think you did ask if you could address the committee, and Committee, are you happy for me to allow the usual 5 minutes, Mr. Brace?
Yeah.
Do you want to come and take a seat? And we'll be 5 minutes if that's okay. And we'll give you an indication when you're a minute away from time.
I'll sit here so people can see when I speak. Thank you, Chair, for granting me the opportunity to speak for up to 5 minutes on the draft protocol for webcasting, filming and recording of council meetings, which can be found on pages 15 to 18 of the agenda reports pack. Those with long memories may remember my email of the 1st of March 2015, and that I spoke on the what is now the existing policy at the public meeting of the Standards and Constitutional Oversight Committee held on the 3rd of March 2015. The minutes of that meeting are published on the council's website, and the video of that meeting is also a matter of public record. The recommendations from that meeting, including an agreed amendment, were then agreed at the council meeting held on the 16th of March 2015. As a result of that decision in March 2015, council granted delegated decision-making powers in this area to the Standards and Constitutional Oversight Committee. The new draft policy is completely different to the existing policy, and I'm grateful to Gwen Swinburne for highlighting that it is, with some minor differences to committee names and job titles, and some amendments made by the Standards and Constitutional Oversight Working Group. The policy was agreed at the City of York Council meeting held on the 21st of July 2016. This had been recommended and amended by the City of York Council's Governance Committee's meeting held on the 10th of May 2016. As far as I can tell, apart from the publication of the reports for this meeting a week ago, there's been no formal consultation with the media or public about the parts of this new policy that apply to them. The second sentence of paragraph 15 is a major change to the existing policy, as the existing policy allows filming by the press or public where the public is seated in the meeting room. This leads to the question, who will decide where this designated area is for public meetings held, the Wallasey Town Hall in the Council Chamber and committee rooms 1 to 3? Will it be decided by the Chair on a meeting-by-meeting basis? What will be the designated area for public meetings at, say, the local pensions board and constituency committee meetings, as are often held on premises not owned or controlled by the local council? Will there be enough space in the designated area for multiple members of the press and public expecting to film or report on a meeting are there? Or will there even be be chairs in those areas for those with disabilities. If a member of the public seated in a public area takes out their mobile phone and takes a photo or films the meeting, will they be immediately asked to move to a different area of the room to so do, or will they be allowed to do this from where they sit? At the present time, many members of the public have complained during various public meetings held at Worcester Town Hall, often out loud during the meeting itself, that they cannot hear during the meeting what councillors or other speakers are saying. Despite usually sitting near the front, at times I have trouble hearing what is said due to in part the lack of microphones, distance to those speaking, and background noise from outside, such as hearing committee room 3, noise from the car park with emergency fireworks, the tea and coffee machine. I know there are councillors with hearing aids who really struggle to understand what is being said during meetings. The proposed policy on will council phone is open for meetings doesn't state how long the footage will be retained and published for. Despite encouraging others who film to allow non-commercial reuse, it is silent on decisions on reuse of the video footage filmed by World Council itself, how this will be decided and whether the charge will be made. Paragraph 15 seems to ignore the fact that the law on a person's presence at the meeting and filming the meeting are not linked. Filming can happen without a person's presence at the meeting, and what's to stop the person leaving their recording equipment still recording behind if the person filming is classed as disruptive or distracting and forced to leave. There is no law that requires the public or press not to distract councillors and others at meetings, for example, clapping and applause will be outlawed. Does that mean people aren't allowed to nod or shake their head or even laugh at a joke? It's already a criminal offence to act in a disorderly manner for the purpose of preventing the transaction of business for which the meeting was called in the Public Meeting Act 1908. And will council only has the legal power to exclude people from the public part of the meeting, does the press or prevent disorderly conduct or other misbehaviour? And of course, enforcement of the criminal law is down to Merseyside Police. Will Council's own constitution requires the chair to give a verbal warning first and ask the person or parents to stop before any such powers exercised. It has been used in the past by the mayor at a council meeting and a person had a disability and no or little control over their disruptive behaviour in the mayor later apologised. It is impossible for Will Council to think it can dictate to people who are press or members of the public how and where they should be filming and how it's done, as many will be unaware of the policy.
Grace, you have 1 more minute.
Thank you. I recommend that there is a consultation over the draft policy with the public and if the committee wishes to approve the policy tonight, that the second sentence in paragraph 15 is deleted for the reasons I have outlined. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much as well. And the committee notes your comments. I know that also you've submitted a list of questions and that you've had written responses to all those questions and so far, thanks to the committee. So, is there anybody else have a comment on today? We did discuss this at some length.
So, Chair, if I may, just very, very quickly, the agenda item 5, the document has got track changes, so members can see where the document has changed since the working group, and they're appearing on page 16, 17, and 18. But for clarification, we've got a few additional recommendations that with regard to paragraphs 15, 17 and 18, where the references to public meetings, that these be changed to meetings held in public.
Okay,
it's just a clarification.
Okay. Phil, did you want to say something?
A few considerations for me. Somebody who's been through the death, apart from the noise and the coffee issue, but totally making it difficult for me to hear things, is that whoever's filming, wherever they are, whoever's recording, wherever they are, wherever they sit, wherever that might be designated, it should be that the members of the public should have full sight of the committee in process. The public have come to hear an item, they want to see it dealt with, and want to hear the debate. So that's why there's an issue of trying to avoid disruption in what we want, so people can see and hear what's going on. If officers want to discuss with whoever forms meetings, where their equipment best place is.
I think you're talking about people other than the official filming.
Yes. So, for instance, today we have a tripod, and there's plenty of room between the committee and the tripod. At our times, when the committee room 3 is quite packed with citizens, and therefore moving things around seems to strike me that we need to be clear about safety in case anyone, don't think anyone ever has, but somebody might one day fall over a tripod or cash flare footage and so on. So we need to have some idea of where it might be for everyone's protection.
Okay, thank you very much. Anybody else?
Yeah. Just one second, which is to say on that point, and what some of the others raised today and in the working group, there have been two pieces of guidance from the Secretary of State from when this was brought in as something official that was a legal requirement. The policy that you've got has been checked against that. Both of them are very brief and contain such statements as, I think it was raised earlier, for example, that if recording equipment can't be left in a room unattended, members of the public should be expected that the right is that a member of the public may record, not that they can bring in the recording equipment and to be left, so that should be expected to be within the room. And the overriding point is the government policy that councillors may reasonably ask for filming to be undertaken in such a way that is not disruptive or distracting to the good order and conduct of the meeting. And that's what this is trying to do here. So it's trying to strike that balance between, as you say, the physicality of some recording equipment that maybe seems to be getting in the way, and that's not good. And then also making space in a formal way for those members of the public who don't wish to be recorded to allow for that. Such processes as raised here, which is about the designated space for recording where there's significant physical equipment, is not unusual, that's become standard. And indeed, that spins out of the government guidance that talks about those who wish to record council meetings should, wherever possible, discuss that first with officers of the council so that it can be put in a place and a way that is not disruptive to the meeting and is conducive to the order. So that's the principles that lie behind the process.
Yeah, I fully accept the principles and never accept everything that really said. As an exercise, purely as an exercise, let's assume Committee Room 3 is full of members of the public wishing to hear something. Where would we expect somebody wanted to film to be a designated area? Let's say we have, you know, every seat was taken by members of the public, people standing. Would it be right that somebody should be allowed to take a seat, two seats, to film the proceedings? Or should they be given to members of the public?
So, if I may, so that would be the subject of conversation with the person wishing to film a meeting. So, for example, there's a large tripod here today. If this room was full of members of the public and it was seen that that tripod was disruptive because it was getting in people's way and they were tripping over it and there wasn't room to stand, then we'd have a discussion with that person and probably ask them to hold the equipment by hand rather than using a tripod or using just one leg of the tripod and then keeping it steady by hand. So it will be a conversation.
So that will be on a meeting-to-meeting basis?
Yes.
And I'm sure we'll review to see how it has worked once it's been in practice for a while. Are we happy to agree this protocol, Emma?
Please.
Thank you very much. Can we move on to the next item on the agenda, which is agenda item 6, social media policy.
What's before you today, I believe, is something you've discussed in the
group. We did.
I don't know whether the members who were there, fortunately it wasn't at the last meeting, may wish to say further, but actually the use of social media is obviously it's increasing, it's what lots of people use, and is indeed a means of recording meetings in itself. So it's helpful both the members and officers and members of the public to understand to a greater degree what that means in terms of use of social media's impact on your life. So what you have here is a generic social media policy proposed for adoption by yourselves. If you forgive me, I think the next stage may well be a protocol for members, because there are some very useful protocols out there for members and giving guidance to members on how you react. And with the council itself in terms of social media, that's been found to be very useful. So if that.
Thank you. I think as a starting point, this is helpful. But we are aware that, especially for elected members, you can get yourself into a bit of a mess if you don't care.
So this is that first generic step and guidance to one and all about what social media is and if I may, the dangers that come with that.
At the moment, this is for noting. Okay, can I ask
anybody
else a question?
Yeah. Yeah. Again, Chair, this is a slightly revised document, very, very minimally revised document from that considered for the working group. On page 19, again, track changes, section 2, the first paragraph. This is just but not limited to, it's just to broaden the coverage. And again, on page 23, section 10, where members requested that this section be beefed up a little bit, so the following groups must also adhere to members, consultants, staff, etc.
Thank you. Thanks,
Patrick.
Okay, we're happy to
check on procedure. We can take this here. Where does it go? When members of staff turn on the internet, whatever it's called, and see various policies, is it going there? And then look at that, it's only there with all the other stuff.
Yes, Councillor Gilbert, it's through you, Chair. This is the existing social media policy for the Council. It's on the Council website, intranet for members of staff. These minor revisions will be highlighted.
Okay. Ron?
Yeah, can I just put down to paragraph 10? Elected members.
Yeah.
And adhere to the policy. It hasn't been related policy, but some do, some don't with these councillors. So I think we just need to have clarity actually what policy did the councillors come under. We know what the social media policy is, and we continue to adhere to that. And I'm mindful that one's got disciplinary procedure policy in the background. It's got capability and performance policy. It then has code of practice for employees, and then it goes on to IT security protocol. That might cross over into councillors, but there's no clear clarity exactly what other policies do the council come under. I know we come under the social media one, but there's also related policies as well that just want some clarity. Where do we actually cross over, and do we have to be mindful of the other additional policies that may interact with the social media policy?
Well,
as
I
understand it, I think it's something that needs to be brought
back. As I understand it, what this policy is saying is that there are related policies that will be implemented by this policy. I think there's an overlap. I think, it just relates to those. I'm not quite sure I understand what you mean, to be honest.
Well, it's clarity, actually, because this first here, the following, who's proposed to come up by this policy? That's a social media policy, which also relates to...
Are we actually looking at paragraph 12, when you're looking at related policy?
No,
paragraph
10.
Yeah,
the wording there, Chair, and I'll read the wording to you. Following groups must also adhere to this policy, and that is the elected members, consultants, agents, staff, volunteers, contractors, external organisations, and work with the council. But it also had related policies under 12. And just as clarity of what actually policies would council come under 12. Because we've got to adhere to one, you adhere to the one.
Should link in,
though,
I think. That's the logic.
Yeah, but it's quite something like that, isn't it?
You get it.
Yes.
Yeah,
so
Phil understands what
you're
saying and
they don't get it. Well, that's why I need a
technical
legal mind,
because I really apply. Instead of my legal mind, okay, well,
I haven't opened my mouth yet, so I've got to go wrong. So there is horses for courses kind of thing. So this is the generic policy covering all of those people. And so there's the question that's asked next, really, which is, well, actually, if somebody doesn't adhere to this policy, and that's where we start to get into paragraph 12. So, for example, so it says members should adhere to this, so you must now adhere to this, but, for example, it will be fairly obvious disciplinary capability, code of practice for employees, etc., simply wouldn't apply to you. But the code of conduct for members would. And vice versa.
It should be stated here,
yes, it should. so that should be. So it's kind of answering that next question in a terribly polite way by not saying whatsoever, which is, if you don't follow this, where does it take you?
Well, actually, it's quite expensive at that juncture, is it not?
Okay, are we happy to agree this is as a policy?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Item 7. Just go to your list, because I know that you're looking for us to make comment on the review the document that we've got in the appendix. And you're also a delegation to respond to our email, is that right?
Yes, Chair. Because we wouldn't presume for example, when the DCLG asked for consultation in December, and we brought a report to this meeting, it was a fairly technical question and therefore got fairly technical answers, albeit in some places we sort of put words into your mouths as a recommendation which you could then support or amend when it came to the meeting. This is a much more of an open discussion to be had with the Committee on Standards and Public Life, and therefore we haven't sought to make any comment whatsoever. So it's here for you to discuss, and what we're seeking from you is we will fill in blanks where you tell us to, but also we will take away the sense of what you're about to have as a discussion and send that on to.
Are you happy if we take it section by section? Because I think we will have comments on part of this, won't we? So, look at the first section. Are the structures, processes, and practices in place working to ensure high standards of conduct by local councillors? If not, say why. Are we all right on page 30? I'm looking at, sorry. What, if any, are the most significant gaps in the current ethical standards regime for local government? So are we happy that the structure is there for us to make sure that councillors are conducting themselves in the way that they should?
There's a bit about the sanctions further down. Yeah, I think the structures are there.
The structures are there, sanctions. The sanctions is the bit that's going to concern us, isn't it? So do we want to make, does anybody want to make a comment on that section? No?
No, I think the
structures
are all in place.
Investigations and decisions on allegations, are we... Proceeds, okay. Are we happy with the whole section? Go to sanctions.
No, I don't think we are.
Go on then.
Given our experience of one individual case that we've gone on for some considerable time, what we haven't got is time scales. It should be actually action by and dealt with, and then, you know, obviously whatever comes out. But there's none of that in this. It rolls on, and then the people provide the case by not complying or responding. The time goes on, the time goes on, and that's why we've been threatened by members of the public.
Yeah.
You know, with animals.
So what we're looking for is a mechanism to stop in drift.
Yeah.
There's two elements to it, really, isn't there? There is, first of all, that the procedure, the normal procedure, is followed in a fairly rigorous time frame. But there's also that there's some sort of mechanism to stop deliberately falling for, you know, drift. Somebody's deliberately playing the system to keep on avoiding sure. Take to task for behaviour.
On the same thing, we need to, on our submission, I think we need to be mindful of not imposing a time scale that just allows allegations to be will go to border because it hasn't been seen within a time scale.
That's a fair point. It's a fair point. So some sort of compromise on that, because we've had so many occasions where literally they've taken years before they've been completed. Fairly standard complaints, I think, have taken years before they've been completed. Not to say the more complicated ones.
What I mean by that is that if there was a time limit, like complaints have to be heard within 6 months, if they're disregarded, then the complaint can't be heard because maybe that person under investigation deliberately delays that. So there's got to be a mechanism where
development
has been. And I'm not saying extend because I think it is ridiculous in the past where we've gone on for years. But you know, if their personal circumstances don't allow them to take part in the process, then the process must continue. It mustn't be allowed to deliberately drag on.
Okay.
Thank
you very much. Yes, Ron.
Just on two first, and I think it's the working and the first, and whether that role should be strengthened. I think that's something we need to consider on how we can strengthen that role and make it more amenable. On investigation, certain of allegations against the two.
Yes.
So it's a current requirement for producing papers must be taken into account before the site and my allegations sufficient to assure objective fairness and decision. But should this requirement be strengthened?
I think, yeah.
Given our experience, do we feel that that's something we should be commenting on?
Just so I don't lose the thread from the chair, is it easy for us if we could just go down these questions in order? That's a bit of a jump,
okay.
And maybe another discussion.
We'll just deal with the timescale first. I'll come to you in a minute.
So I'm still on A and B.
No, we've moved on.
Investigations and allegations over.
So that's why I'm talking about that. I wouldn't be talking about the others.
Yeah, and then the first point that was made was that we over timing for investigations. That we like the procedure. We think the procedure is the right procedure. We think there's possibly a flaw in it, in that there's no time scale involved that we can see, and therefore that's led to drift or deliberate attempts to postpone things. But we don't want the time frame to be such that it rules something out of order. If it's not done with that time frame, it gets ruled out of order, gets dropped.
But I think these timescales and mechanisms exist to ensure prompt investigation and determination of allegations.
But the point that Paul's making is that that's right. We don't want things a timescale, which means that after say 6 months, if it's not been heard, then it falls away and doesn't get followed up. And then Ron's point is when we get to the part where the independent persons.
Can I just also make a comment on that? There's a good point. There's a fact that I think it needs to be, when you get an individual that fabricates, delays the process, your time scales don't mean diddly squat. Is it not strengthening up the whole thing that the person, the complainant and the complainer have a clear guidance on what they should adhere to? And that's what I'm saying, because one individual can disrupt the whole process by being non-compliant. That there is a duty upon councillors to be compliant with the legislation and regulations.
I think that's incorrect. Thank you, we understand that. The next part, and I will come to you in a minute, Chris. The next part is the part of the independent person in the process. At this point, when we've done these things, the independent person has is asked for a comment on the procedure and whether they are happy with the way that things have been conducted, and that has been very valuable part of the whole procedure. Now, is that sufficient, or should they? They don't have voting rights in the procedure. Are we looking at whether or not they should? I personally have no objection to that, but you know, I wouldn't know about independent people whether or not they feel your voice. I'm looking for really in this. And then I'll come to Chris first, and then Phil. Because Chris has been very patient.
Okay. With regard to what I'm saying, I agree, and I also agree, disagree to a point with Paul saying. The only, from my knowledge and what I'm like, is the only timescale in the Constitution that deals, that has a set time, is from when a complaint is made. That then the person complained about needs to be notified within 5 working days or something like that, can't remember what it is now. But after that, it's all discussed. Now, and I hear what Paul says about we mustn't let standards complaints just be overturned because they've not been heard. Well, if they've not been heard because it's a fault of this committee or a fault of officers, then I think they should be allowed to be just dreadful. With regards to this committee and the officers, we have the right to hear that complaint without them being present. So we can set a deadline, we can say 6 months. If you don't turn up, well, we're going to hear it anyway. So there is that. Should complaints be disregarded because they're not here in time? If it's our fault and the fault of the officers, yes. If it's somebody trying to swing the lead, we'll be not compliant to delay it, then no, because we will hear it within that set time scale. So I would like to see a system that says that the person is notified within those working days, that the monitoring officer will then have so long to look at the situation to determine whether it needs, how it can be resolved, whether it's remediation or whether it needs to be investigated. And that should be done within maybe 28 days. And if it's going to extend investigation, then the time scale is set for that investigation to take place. And then the hearing takes place at the end of that. It's not rocket science, it's quite simple. I think a standard complaint from start to finish should be no longer than 6 months, unless it's particularly complex.
I actually can't find any flaw in that. I think it brings together everything that we've said in a way that is workable. So are we happy to put that forward as our view on that?
Yeah.
I'm going back, because Professor Jones, I know I've asked to quite say,
yeah.
It's the voice of the independent person on this part. Do you feel that your role is sufficiently robust in this process today? Because you have had some experience of doing this.
Indeed. Thank you, Chair. No, I think that under E2, the views of the independent person must be sought. I mean, I think that's fairly strong.
Yeah.
And taken into account. And as long as they're sought and taken into account, I can't see any point in
You're not looking that. For a vote when it comes to decision making.
Well, I mean, that's a probably a broader aspect, isn't it, really?
Well, I think it's implied in the point that's made. Are we happy that your view being sought and heard is sufficient, or do we need to formalise that in some way?
Well, I think we agree it's formalised. If you sought and heard, and then the independent person goes to a hearing, the independent person is there, and we have the chance then to talk to the independent person.
Okay.
The independent person can say,
the only thing is, when it comes to a vote on a decision, they don't have a vote. Certainly, the elected members are on the panel that have a vote. If we feel it is okay, then we'll leave it at that point. I
don't have any strong views on that.
Just on the way, just a question for the monitoring officer. Does he feel that his role as both investigator and deliverer of the recommendation from the investigating officer, does that bring conflict in his role as a monitoring officer? And if so, does he believe there's a risk to his role, and does he think we need to do anything? If he says no, that's the matter's closed. Just an opinion of the monitoring officer.
I'm happy to comment, Chair. I just want to be sure that you've answered the point you were discussing before.
Yes, I think we're to leave it all changed. Unless, what are you talking about, Phil?
Well, yes. On the point of the first point we had, point down, was actually getting measures together so our own hands to make sure that we do actually convene ourselves to deal with the complaint in a reasonable time. It seems to drag on at some point in the past. The second thing is, there's a complainant. I think we have experience that the person who's being complained about, not responding in the timely manner to inquiries made of that person. So I think Chris's point was that if it appears that the person complained about isn't providing information in a decent time, and there seems to be no reasonable valid explanation for that, we should be able to trigger the process and get on with it.
Yeah.
So finding that form of words. On the issue of Professor Jones, I think the person had two hearings, and I think the issue is like on those enormous cases in the city where people were judging business interests and travel for years in fraud cases. By the time we get to the end of them, the jury, some of them passed away or retired or whatever.
I have no intention of doing that.
We extended on one or two occasions quite late at night, and the opportunity for the independent member to comment was, I think, really left towards the very end of all the proceedings. And I think we need to introduce the way in which the independent person, whoever might be, can ask for more information at any point as a right or as a comment.
I think you're right that the time has come at the end when we formally ask the independent person to make their comment. That doesn't exclude them commenting at any stage through procedure or asking questions if they want to earlier on. What at the end of it, just to make sure that we've fulfilled the requirement of the process, then I think you have asked, do you want to make a comment? And Professor Jones, don't see Professor Jones in that role, I think, has given his view about whether the process was fair and open and whether a proper hearing was made. So I think that he's not excluded from asking questions about the process, but he must be formally, he, she, must be formally requested at the end to give their view, and I think that sorts of stuff.
I do think it's an important thing because we've heard all the information coming from all sides, and then we're in a much better position to express an opinion at the end than we would be halfway through. Okay, but I think the point that we can ask for information.
Okay.
Thank you.
Briefly, because I'm.
No, just to bring it back to the point that I was making, and I agree with Chris. It's whoever is frustrating the process. So in the past, whether there be timescales for officers' availability or councillors on this committee's availability, you know,
you're happy then that what Chris has said has incorporated everybody's concern.
Yeah, I think so. With regard to the independent investigator or the independent person, I question whether part of their recommendations and their report can be a recommendation too.
It's different, Paul. We're not talking about the independent investigator, we're talking about the part played at the end of hearing by the independent person, not the independent investigator. That's the person who produces the report, which we're basing our findings. But the independent person is one of these four people who would sit in at the panel, and at the end of the process, they would be formally asked to give their view of what they've heard. It's different from what we've heard. Okay? And what was the question that Ron's raised?
So, what's asked there is actually three separate questions to procedure. The first is, can military officers be subject to a conflict of interest? Yes. Is the answer to that, of course. And we need to ensure that there are sufficient safeguards to do that. And I'm quite satisfied that here we do, because we have a deputy monitoring officer. So, for example, I cannot be both investigator and advisor to you on the final judgment. And there are other kinds of conflicts of interest. So, for example, the firm of which I am a part bid for one of the investigator positions. So that was passed over to the deputy monitoring officer. I had absolutely no chance to do that as soon as it became aware that my firm may bid for work involved in the business. And we have sufficient people in place to enable that to happen.
So are we comfortable that there are safeguards to protect you from?
Comfortable for that. The next is undue pressure. That does happen. I haven't seen it happen here, but I've seen it happen in other places. There were previously safeguards for that, and still some are. So for example, a monitoring officer in carrying out their duties can demand whatever resources that they think are sufficient to do the job. So if I say to the council, I need X, and the council says, well, we haven't got the money for that, I say, I don't care. I have X, please, because the law says so. So that safeguard is in there and enables us to do things like, when something is very big, there may be pressure to say, investigate it yourself, and we say, no, actually, this is too big, too important, too politically sensitive, it's going out. Now, the result of that, in some places, is that there's then little discussions about, well, how long do you really want to be in this job for, and then handling things like that. And there are employment protections in place. Those have been watered down, as some of you will be aware. One of the last things that the last Secretary of State did just before he left is to issue a directive that watered down the employment protection of this role and the Chief Finance Officer role and the End of Paid Service role. It's no secret that that made many people uncomfortable about doing this job, because it meant those protections from that bullying weren't there, and that is a concern, of course. But that's, as I say, simply my point of view. And then the last point is to say that there is, and has been for a number of years, what's called a Monitoring Officer Protocol, which is simply a list of statements that people are more aware of what we do and how we can go about doing it. There's a model that's out there that's adopted by a lot of councils. So it says quite clearly, for example, if the monitoring officer for the purpose of this kind of investigation of any other kind wants to join a meeting, other than a group meeting, but any meeting of the council, they can. And no one can say, we don't want you anything, go on. So that kind of stuff, that will, I think, will give reassurance to both this committee and to the individuals involved. Systems of recommendations from the Committee of Standards in Public Life, that they recommend that protocol. Although, as I say, it is about half of the councils I'm aware of come across have such a protocol.
Okay, and moving on now to the part on sanctions, I think we will want that.
At some point, yes, we've skipped over our whole section.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Yes.
Okay. Want to do this or
do you want to go to the bit that we're all looking to get to is the
sanction.
Yeah, we'll get that out of the way. Code of conduct for councils clear and easily understood. And do the codes cover the appropriate range of behaviours? What examples of good practice, including induction processes, etc., exist?
Can I just point out, Chair, that under the Localism Act, obviously there is a considerable amount of freedom over what codes of conduct look like. So yours is fairly comprehensive. Yours follows pretty much the previous model. So on declarations of interest, for example, it spreads out a greater amount of detail and sets out to a great extent the standards that are expected of members. So yours is a sufficient, proficient, and full code of conduct. One of the reasons that question is there is that is not the case everywhere. And in some places, it is very simply our code of conduct has to be based on the Lola principles, so there's the Lola principles. And that's it.
But ours is more comprehensive.
Yours is more comprehensive.
And we don't really need to I think for all of us, apart from perhaps Paul, the induction process was a long time ago.
It was.
And we can't remember anything about it. So I don't know whether there's a view about the process that exists now.
No, I think it's a process.
And you remember doing yours?
No, but I've had to study it. My role as chief of that, the council's government. As well as
well, actually, Ron, they're not asking, is our induction process okay? They're saying, do we consider